Hey friends, Alisa Childers here. Today we're going to continue our discussion with Marcia Montenegro. Last week she shared her testimony of walking out of New Age and into Christianity. Today we're going to talk about New Age ideas. Do you think New Age is out of date and kind of passé? Think again, it's everywhere. We're going to talk about it on today's podcast. If you haven't had a chance to listen to part one of this series, I just want to encourage you to go back and listen to last week's episode, Marcia's story of walking out of the New Age community. She was a really respected voice in that community, a professional astrologer. And then her story of coming to the knowledge of Christ and putting her faith in Christ is just fascinating. So I just want to encourage you to listen to that before you listen to this one, because today we're going to get more into what New Age ideas are and how they're manifesting in culture and in the church. So that's going to be a really interesting discussion as well. But before we get to that, I want to give a few updates about stuff that's going on. I mentioned last week on the podcast that I was going to be reviewing the book Girl, Wash Your Face by Rachel Hollis. I had no idea what an absolutely incredibly popular book this was. I hadn't even heard of it until about a week ago. So I reviewed that book, put that out on Monday, and have been so thrilled to see that God has really used it. It seems to have been really well received, and gotten a lot of messages from people who were really thankful that, you know, that when they read what I had written, it kind of put into words what they were feeling when they read the book as well. So I'm so thankful that God has used that post. I'm going to be recording an episode with Hillary Ferrer at Mama Bear Apologetics on the book, because we were talking about it, and my aim for the post was I wanted to connect with people who liked the book, and that was my goal, and to, you know, shine light and expose some of the lies in the book, but also to share the gospel. So there was a lot I left out. There was a lot more I had to say about the book. So we're going to kind of talk about that on the Mama Bear Apologetics podcast. And I, of course, will post that on my social media when that's available, but we're going to be recording that this week. So that's something to be looking for coming up. Another thing coming up is if you are in the Southern California area, there is a great conference called the Women in Apologetics Conference, and I got to lead worship and speak at it last year, and I'll be doing that again this year. It's at Biola University, January 11th and 12th. And, you know, if you're a woman who's kind of typically not real into women's ministry because you find it kind of fluffy and superficial, like, this is your conference. This is where we dive into deep issues, apologetic and theological issues, and it was fabulous last year. So you can go to womeninapologetics.com, and there's an event tab you can click on to find the links to register for that. So I'd love to see you there in January in Southern California. So again, that's at Biola University, January 11th and 12th. I think that's pretty much all I have to kind of announce for today. So we're going to just get right back into the discussion we started with Marcia Montenegro last week. And here we go. Marcia, now that we've heard your story, let's get into more specifics about what New Age is, what New Agers believe, just about Jesus, God, sin, all these kinds of things. But I think one question that might be on people's minds as they're listening to this is, you know, isn't New Age kind of passé? I mean, is that even really a thing anymore? Is that something people really on a mainstream level are even into anymore?
Yes, and I'm glad that you are asking that, because I think a lot of people do think it's passé. Mm-hmm. They have a stereotyped view of it as people who are doing these sort of fringe things like meditating under, you know, shapes of pyramids and, you know, yeah, going around with crystals. And I mean, yes, there are some people doing that, but I think they see it as this kind of extreme fringe thing, and that has kind of just disappeared. And what actually has happened is that the New Age has taken on a more mainstream persona and has blended with mainstream areas like psychology and in education and in health. And because of that, people aren't seeing it as New Age. Some people might see it as spiritual, and some people might not even recognize that it's spiritual. But I think the term New Age has so many stereotypes attached to it that, and we don't see some of those more obvious things anymore. They aren't as common. So people think that it doesn't exist anymore. Right. But in actuality, it's mainstreamed. And that is part of the deception of the New Age, is that it is very adaptable. Mm. It's very fluid and it's very adaptable. That is the nature of the New Age. And that's what makes it so successful in infiltrating the culture.
Right, because it can adapt with each different kind of generation that comes up. And well, what exactly is New Age? If you could define it, describe it, help us understand really clearly, what is New Age?
Okay, yes, I would like to do that. And I'm always modifying my...
Yeah, right, as it adapts and changes, right?
Yeah, because I'm always trying to refine it. And now I tend to call the New Age a network of beliefs and practices. And this network has a spectrum that goes from a very Eastern, like the Eastern spirituality, where people are into maybe Buddhism or into Hindu beliefs and practices, all the way over into a more Gnostic area where they're into, let's say maybe the Gnostic Gospels, mm-hmm. or believing in these teachings, inner teachings, and that you have the inner teacher, the teacher within you, and you have the spiritual path that unfolds within you, and you find the right teacher, and you go further from that over the spectrum more to what is from an area called New Thought, where it's about the power of your thoughts and your words, and that you have within you the ability to succeed at anything that you truly desire if you believe that you can do it, and if you understand that you have this divine capacity within you to achieve these things, and you follow certain techniques to do it. And so that's the spectrum. So it goes from the Eastern to this kind of Gnostic area to this New Thought area. And there can be overlap. You know, there are people that might be into two of those areas, maybe even with a little bit of the third area. So mm-hmm. I have it kind of there in three general areas, the Eastern, the Gnostic, and the New Thought. Mm-hmm. But there's all these blends and forms of it, variations of it. And that's what makes it so hard to define and makes it hard for people to identify, is because there are so many variations. Now, despite the fact there is this big network, it's held together with certain kind of core beliefs that you tend to find in the New Age, which is that there is a God in the New Age, but this God is usually impersonal. Or sometimes, and this is contradictory, but in the New Age you can have contradictions, God is personal and impersonal. So you, for example, the Conversations with God books by Neil Donald Walsh, which were on the bestseller list for several years, I think, you have him getting messages from this God who's personal. But yet this God explains to him that the universe came out of him. So it's, you know, it's this kind of contradictory thing of an impersonal God and a personal God. So you can have both of those views, and people will adapt different views of God. They'll take even Christian elements and into the New Age God. So you just have so many varieties there that you don't just have one kind of God. Then Jesus, there are some variations there, but usually Jesus is either he's always seen as some kind of spiritual master, but beyond that, or maybe the avatar of the age of Pisces, but beyond that, Jesus is seen as representing something within everybody that you can achieve, which is usually called Christ consciousness. So when you realize your true nature, your divine nature, or that your nature comes from God, and you go on a spiritual path, then you can achieve this Christ consciousness, this awareness of your inner Christ divinity, so to speak. That's a very common New Age view. It comes actually from the New Thought movement, which was a big movement in the mainly the 1800s and early 1900s. But it started in the 1700s with a man named Swedenborg. And that's, but that is, the New Age adapted a lot of New Thought ideas. And that's a real big one that's in the New Age.
So that's, in that sense, Jesus is like not so much a sinless savior that's, you know, God incarnate, but more like an example of someone who, just like the rest of us, have the same potential inside of us. He tapped into something.
Yeah.
That, and he realized something within himself. And so he's an example for us to follow, and we can achieve that same kind of divinity.
Exactly.
Is that kind of a fair way to say it?
Yeah.
Because I actually, interestingly, my specialty is progressive Christianity. And you find that idea in progressive Christianity a lot as well, which is kind of interesting. And I was going to ask you this too. So you're kind of describing New Age as a bit of a hodgepodge. There's Eastern thought, there's Gnostic gospels, things like this. And I think, and I've seen you post about this on Facebook too, that there's quite a bit of sort of pseudoscience involved as well.
Yes.
And have you seen the YouTube video of Deepak Chopra and Richard Dawkins? I'm sure you have.
Oh, I don't know. I've seen that one. I need
okay.
to see that
well,
one.
Well, I'll post a link to that underneath too, but it's so interesting because Deepak Chopra is basically talking about what he's calling quantum healing. And he's trying to bring physics in to what he's describing. And so Richard Dawkins is sort of interviewing him. And it's really kind of interesting because Dawkins, of course, is a scientist. And so he's asking these really specific questions. And he gets Deepak Chopra to the point where Chopra is basically backed into a corner. And so Richard Dawkins says, so why are you calling it quantum? Where does the quantum element come in? And you kind of see Deepak Chopra scramble a little bit, and he says, well, it's a metaphor. So he's actually saying it's a metaphor. So he's basically, this whole teaching that he has, that he's peddling as based in science, when he was actually interviewed by a scientist, he had to admit, well, actually that whole idea of using physics and quantum is really more metaphorical. So I thought that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, that would be interesting to see. Yeah, because, and this whole thing of using quantum is very big in the New Age. Mm-hmm. There is a movie that came out a number of years ago called What the Bleep Do We Know? Have you seen that?
No, I haven't.
Yeah, you should see it. I think it's probably pretty available in some way. And it was actually made by the woman out in what state does she live in? Is it Washington State? The woman who calls herself her Jay-Z Knight, and supposedly channels the teachings of this 35,000-year-old warrior named Ramtha.
Oh, wow.
And very new. She runs basically a New Age cult, and has for a number of years. And she's behind this movie, What the Bleep Do We Know? And the whole premise of the movie is trying to use quantum physics as a way to explain how everything's interconnected.
Right.
And actually, I read a book, the first book on that tried to do that was called The Tao of Physics by a physicist named Fritjof Capra that I read in the late 70s.
Hmm.
I think the book came out in 77 or something, and I read it a year or two later. And it really had an effect on me because he makes it seem very true, and he's a physicist. Now, that book has been debunked by a lot of physicists, if you go on and Google it. But this idea of the quantum universe and the quantum physics and everything proving this interconnected kind of energy or force that you can use, it's spiritual and you can use it for healing, is very, very big in the New Age because the New Age always wants to try to sound scientific. It always wants to try to use science to give itself credibility. And this is one of the ways they do it. And Deepak Chopra talking about this quantum healing is a good example. In fact, I think he wrote a book called The Dancing Wooly Masters, which is the same idea as The Tao of Physics by Fritjof Capra.
Uh-huh.
I never read The Dancing Wooly Masters, but that is what it is. It's about this quantum physics thing.
Yeah.
And so Yeah, so they always try to use science, and it's really pseudoscience. And they try to use these ideas about energy, and what they do is they, you know, they take the word energy and they really equivocate on it, because then they talk about real forms of physical energy, like electrical energy. But then they use the word energy to really mean the kind of energy they're talking about, which is this unquantifiable, immeasurable, invisible kind of force.
Yeah,
and this is used, of course, in what is called energy healing, which is very, very big in the New Age, and unfortunately has gotten into the church. A lot of New Age practices are in the church. This is one of my biggest battles in my ministry, because these things are all bogus, and they're based on spiritual beliefs, but they're very big in the church. And the even the concept of energy now, I see some Christians falling for this idea. And sometimes you see some Christians trying to equate it with the Holy Spirit. So, of course, that's a real problem, because the Holy Spirit is a person. The Holy Spirit's not an energy or a force.
Right.
And you certainly don't manipulate or channel the Holy Spirit.
Right.
So, you know, it's but unfortunately, there is a big deception there. And that area of pseudoscience and pseudoscientific healing is huge. And I think the New Age has made huge, huge strides in this culture through this bogus healing, to the extent that some major hospitals actually offer some of these practices under the banner of integrative medicine.
Wow.
Integrative healing. And I'm always doing posts on red flag words, and integrative is one of them. If it's used in terms of medicine or healing, I say that is a big, big, big red flag, because what they're saying is, we're offering some bogus treatments along with with real treatments.
So integrative means bogus. Just put that in your mind.
Yeah, or it's mixed in. It's like, well, you know, we can do this, which is medical. But, you know, if you'd also like the choice of, you know, this particular practice, if you would like to have Reiki, you know, which is a pure energy healing. And I want to point out that all of these energy healing things are actually occult practices.
Yeah.
And the New Age includes a lot of occult practices, and it's actually occultic. And this is the way, for example, you have healing from psychics and from witches.
Yeah.
It's energy healing. And I had it done to me when I was in the New Age.
So, well, you mentioned, you know, a really important point for Christians is a proper understanding of the Holy Spirit, because, like you said, the Holy Spirit is a person. He's not a force. He's not some sort of impersonal energy field that we can learn how to manipulate and things like this. And you mentioned that this is getting into the church, and I just wanted to tell this quick story just to sort of support what you're saying there. Just about a month ago, I had signed my kids up for a VBS at a local church here, a big church, a church that has a good reputation for being Orthodox. This isn't a liberal church. And I signed them up for the VBS. And so we got there, and the theme was Star Wars. Now, of course, my antenna goes up immediately thinking, okay, surely not, you know, surely they're not going to compare. Maybe it's just the theme. Maybe they're just, you know, it's just a fun thing. And I thought, okay, so they went, and so you can pick your kids up a little early and watch the little 30-minute skit that happens at the end of, this is the first night. This was an evening VBS. And as a mom, I'll admit, I was kind of excited to have 5 weeknights to myself. And so my husband was with me, and we're watching the skit, and they are, as far as I could tell, comparing the Holy Spirit with the Force in Star Wars. In fact, the characters in the skit are describing this force as something you feel in your belly, and it moves its way up into your heart, and that's how you know that you're called to do something. So then they go in and they get their Jedi training. Now, it is possible that they, you know, went in a different direction, but I was uncomfortable enough with what I heard that, in fact, my husband, who's really not Mr. Theology at all, he was sitting there and he turned to me and he goes, well, there went all your weeknights, huh? And I was like, yeah. So I talked to my kids about it. And I just made the choice that at the age, at their particular ages, I did not send them back. You know, and I, granted, it was one night and it, maybe they were going to make a different point. But it was very clear to me that that's the point they were making, was that if you want to understand the Holy Spirit, look at the Force in Star Wars. And this is just an Orthodox run-of-the-mill church, you know.
Yeah, that's very sad. And I think a lot of people have not understood that behind Star Wars is a very strong Taoist and Buddhist concepts, because George Lucas himself is a follower of Eastern beliefs, was very influenced by Joseph Campbell's ideas that are very pagan. Yeah. And when I saw the Star Wars, the first Star Wars movies that came out, and I am old enough, you know, to have gone to those movies as an adult. I was in the New Age, and I was very excited because these movies were expressing all my New Age views.
Yeah.
And I remember saying to somebody, I can't believe these movies are so popular, because this is all the stuff that I believe. You know, the Force is like the Tao. And they constantly talk in the Star Wars movies about the balance. There needs to be a balance in the Force. Mm-hmm. And this, of course, is the view that, that everything, the yin and the yang, there has to be a constant balance to be in harmony. And to have harmony in the universe, you have to balance yin with yang. And so the dark and light side of the Forces are yin and yang. And I'm so aware of this philosophy, and I saw the later movies, the later episodes, and then the more recent ones, except I don't think I've seen The Last Jedi. I think that's the very latest one. I don't think I've seen that one. But I saw The Force Awakens, and I wrote an article on it, and I have articles on the later films pointing out these Eastern philosophies, and I have discussed this many times with youth groups. And I've told them, you know, usually these are teenagers, and I'm saying to them, you know, I'm not telling you, I'm not trying to say, look, it's a sin if you go see a Star Wars movie, you know,
right.
What I'm trying to say is I want you to be discerning
and be
understand of the concepts here that are very anti-Christian in these movements and in these movies, and you need to be aware of them. So it's sad that a church that a very, you know, more traditional and solid type church would use that analogy.
Well, and it's interesting too, you mentioned that when you as a New Ager saw those movies in the theater, you were excited because they were expressing your beliefs.
Yes.
Well, George Lucas was interviewed by Bill Moyers for Time Magazine in the 90s. I think it was like 1999, where he actually said, that was kind of his goal, was to find elements from all different religious systems and try to put them together, and that the Force and the Jedi and this whole idea of what was going on in Star Wars really was a religious symbol. It was supposed to be a spiritual thing. And so he even pointed out, everybody saw it and got excited because they thought we were expressing their views. The Christians did, the Muslims did, you know, the Buddhists did. And I think we all kind of got duped on that one a little bit, but so that's, I'm glad we talked about that, because I always think it's fun to talk about Star Wars in that way. In fact, when I give talks on worldviews, I always analyze the Star Wars movies and try to help people understand that just because there might be something in common with what you believe, like if there's a sense of the afterlife, or even if there's a hinting at a virgin birth, it doesn't mean they're Christians. You know, it doesn't mean it's a Christian worldview.
Exactly.
So, so that's pretty interesting. So we talked about the New Age God. We talked about how New Agers view Jesus.
Can I say one more thing about the New Age Jesus?
Absolutely.
I wanted to point out there's another view where you have Jesus versus the Christ or the Christ spirit. So Jesus is this man who upon whom the Christ spirit descended, and the Christ spirit can descend on anybody. And so basically you have a distinction between Jesus and the Christ. And this is another view in the New Age. Edgar Cayce had this view, and who was called the sleeping prophet. He would go into these trances, and he promoted reincarnation, and he still has a big following. I mean, although he died many years ago. But this Jesus versus Christ view, the reason I wanted to bring that up is because there is somebody who's very influential, who has it, not exactly that view, but it's very similar, named Richard Rohr.
Oh, yes. I'm
sure you know about.
I just finished reading one of his books on the Trinity. Oh, it was very difficult to get through for me, to be honest.
Yes, yes, because he has been influential on this progressive Christianity.
Yeah, a lot of Christians read him. Yeah.
Yeah. And he would influence the emergence, like Rob Bell and Brian McLaren, who have spoken to his conferences. Richard Rohr makes a distinction between Jesus and the Christ, and he has the cosmic Christ, and he apparently is a follower of Teilhard de Chardin. And I've done some Facebook posts on this, and Teilhard de Chardin, who I don't claim to be an expert on at all, but the basic idea is that there's this omega point that is drawing everything in the universe, creation and people and everything, to this one point of spiritual perfection. And Christ is associated with this omega point. And so Richard Rohr has said things like, Jesus died, Christ arose. And he also said, Christ said things Jesus would have never said. Like they're two different entities.
Yeah.
And so I find this thinking, it's not real obvious. You can listen, you know, you can read some things by Richard Rohr or read quotes from him or even hear some of his talks, and you won't necessarily pick up on that. You have to, sometimes you either have to hit the right talk or you have to dig around to discover those are his views. But I listened to a video he did. He did an interview on the cosmic Christ, and a priest interviewed him. And I listened to that video about 11 times. And I wrote it up and did a Facebook post on it. And since then, I've read some things on his blog. And he also identifies as a panentheist.
Yeah.
So pantheism is all is God, God is all. And panentheism is more complicated and harder to identify, but it is a New Age view that that the universe is contained in God, and God is in the universe but also transcends it. And you have a lot of panentheism in the New Age.
Yeah.
And so
I actually personally know progressive Christians who identify themselves as panentheists.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. They don't even mind saying it.
No, they don't. They don't mind saying it. And I think that this is an influence that people should be aware of, that that is out there.
Well, I'm really glad that you brought that up and that you talked a little bit about that, because as part of my research, like I just mentioned, I read Richard Rohr's book on the Trinity. And I found that to be frustrating in the sense that you're right. You have to really, really pay attention, and you have to kind of keep going back, because he'll backpedal. It's like he'll take two steps forward and then one step back, and then a step and a half forward and then one back. And it's like he's basically saying, you are the fourth member of the Trinity. You're really not, but you are. But you're not. Yeah. But yeah, you really are. You know? Like, that's my scholarly analysis of the book. You know? But it's really true. And he's kind of basing the whole thing on this painting that he's just interpreting to mean that.
Yes.
As if that's sort of some kind of theological, you know, thing we should stand on, somebody that painted something. But at any rate, yeah, it is really hard, I think, for the average Christian, for myself, to wade through some of this stuff. But that's why I'm so glad we're having this conversation, because we can begin to identify some of this stuff. And interestingly, this might be a good time to ask you this. I was watching one of those late night talk shows or whatever, and Jim Carrey was on as a guest. And, you know, he has been saying some weird things, and people are kind of going, I've even had some apologetics students email me some videos and going, what is going on with Jim Carrey? And so I want to read you a quote from him, and you can unpack this quote for us, because I think it might have to do with what we've been talking about with pantheism and panentheism. So he said, when the host, I can't remember which show it was, but the host asked him, you know, so how are you doing? And Jim Carrey just smiles and he goes, well, you know, he said, you know, I'm good or whatever. And he said, I'm either a guy experiencing the universe, or I'm the universe experiencing a guy. And then, you know, we hear him say this and we're like, he needs medication. Like, he's going crazy. But actually,
no,
he's not. He's got a worldview. So why don't you help us with that?
Yeah, just based on that quote, I remember seeing some video of him, and I can't remember if I thought it was Buddhist possibly a sort of a Buddhist angle that he was coming from. I need to do some more research on him. Yeah. But yeah, that could be a very new age type statement where I'm either the guy, because in other words, there's no real distinction between the guy and the universe.
Yeah.
Is what he's saying. So yeah. I could be the guy experiencing the universe, or I could be the universe experiencing the guy, because right. It's really the same thing. Uh-huh. You know, I am you and you are me.
Yeah, the interconnectedness.
Yes, yes, we're connected. Yeah. And, you know, it just depends on your perspective or whatever, maybe your the state of your consciousness. And so just on that one little phrase there, yeah, I would say that could be very, very new age. And it is not making a distinction. So there's no distinctions that are being made, which is very much like pantheism.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think I remember the video you're talking about that was going around. I saw a lot of Christians actually posting it as well.
Yeah.
Where Jim Carrey's talking about the universe. And again, I wish I would have watched it before we talked so it could be fresh in my mind. But my memory was that he was really talking about the universe in a very pantheistic way, that the universe really is God and what you want to get from the universe and things like this. So it seems like he's kind of been influenced a bit by that worldview.
Yeah, definitely. I need to check. I need to look him up because there's a lot of actors who have been influenced by Zen Buddhism, and I don't know if that's what he's into. But for some reason, I was thinking that some of the things that I thought I was hearing in what he said sounded sort of Buddhist. But I need to double check on that. Some are influenced by Hindu, by transcendental meditation, which is Hindu-based, and others are influenced by Zen, and there's quite a few of them.
Well, in Christian theology, when we talk about humans, you know, humans are a special creation that God made, that he breathed his life into, made in the very image of God. And you know, that's kind of the Christian view. What's the New Age view of humans and who we are?
Yeah, in the New Age view, we are actually from God, and we are spiritual beings. Our bodies are temporary. So we are in these bodies that are temporary vehicles for our spirit or our soul. And eventually, you know, the goal is that we would be somewhere without a physical body. So it's in that way, it's very Gnostic. That's a very Gnostic side of the New Age. And the body that you're in could be the result of reincarnation. So this is a karmic kind of thing. This is what you earned through your previous life. And or it's a manifestation of your spiritual self. And certainly as you, however you got the body you have, how it's maintained and the health of your body is based on your spiritual maintenance. So illnesses and pain and things are manifestations of problems with the spiritual or with the soul state. So that's why the New Age healing is so spiritually oriented. It's really thinking that, you know, it's not just the body. You have to go into the spiritual state and all of these other things that is causing the problem. Man would be seen as basically divine. We're basically divine, and we have to awaken to that truth. Once you awaken to that truth, then you can be on your spiritual path and you can spiritually progress. In terms of reincarnation, which I would say the belief in reincarnation is pretty essential to the New Age. You could have people dabbling in some New Age practices and some New Age views, maybe without believing in reincarnation. But if they don't believe in reincarnation, I think they're maybe New Age wannabes. I don't know. I don't know that they're true New Agers, because reincarnation is such a staple of the New Age worldview. Or possibly the Buddhist concept of rebirth, which is not exactly the same, but it's also the idea that you eventually, you know, the body is just a temporary. In fact, the body is, this world is not even real. In Buddhism, you don't even have a self. So, but you have this divine self. Now, this is really a lot like Hinduism, because in Hinduism, there's the Atman, A-T-M-A-N, which is like your divine center. And your ego is like the false self. Mm-hmm. And so you have to discover the Atman, and that is what is your true self, is the Atman. So there's a lot of talk about discovering your true self in the New Age and variations of the New Age, and that all comes from that idea. So this whole idea of the true self and awakening to your true self and your true path all has to do with being this divine spiritual being that is trapped basically in a body.
Yeah. Well, and that's interesting how much that bleeds into the church as well, because, of course, biblically, humans are body and spirit. You know, we have two parts. And you hear Christians a lot say this quote that it's attributed to C.S. Lewis, but he never said it, where they'll say, "I am a soul, I have a body." And do you feel like that's a little bit of that New Age thought kind of creeping in? Because, I mean, obviously, biblically, we're going to have a glorified body for eternity. We aren't just, I mean, we are made up of both things. And so, yeah, that's kind of interesting.
And I think actually Teilhard de Chardin said, we are human beings. We are not human beings having a spiritual experience. We're spirits having a human experience. And that's either attributed to him or he actually said it. Yeah. And Richard Rohr has said the same thing. Wayne Dyer, another New Age teacher who died a couple of years ago, also said something very similar and is often quoted with that statement. And I have seen Christians say it. Yeah. And if I am able to respond, I will say something. I will say, no, this is not a Christian worldview. Yeah. We are our body, and we're our material self and our immaterial self is usually the way I like to look at it, avoid arguments about the spirit soul dichotomy.
Yeah, exactly. I know. I was trying. That is much better. Yes.
So, you know, we have a material self and we have an immaterial self.
Yes.
Whatever you call that. God made our bodies, and you have to look, and this is why the physical resurrection of Jesus is so important. The bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ not only is important because it's an essential component of the faith, but because it is against all other religious views. Yeah. There is no other religion that has a resurrection of a glorified body. You know, the closest you have to it are these Egyptian myths where the bodies are cut up and then they're sewn back together or glued back together or something like you do with a broken vase. You don't have an actual resurrection. Yeah. And so this makes Christianity so unique among any religious or spiritual view. There's just nothing else like it. And it also shows to Christians the importance of the body and the fact that a spiritual body doesn't mean a ghost, doesn't mean you're floating around like a ghost.
Yeah.
It's not mortal, so it's going to be different, and we don't really know exactly what it's like to be in such a body.
Right.
But we do know there is some kind of physical element to it.
Yeah.
So it's a real important point to hold to that doctrine about the Christian view, the biblical view of the body.
And most Christians, I think, just your average churchgoer, is not giving a whole lot of thought to that. And that's what makes, I think, you know, it makes what you do so important, because, you know, if we're not really looking at some of these really important Christian doctrines, it's easy to get swept up in something that sounds nice. Like you are a soul, you have a body. That sounds nice, you know?
It does.
And you can see how that could happen. So is there a concept of sin in the New Age? How do they view, you know, personal sin and that sort of thing?
Yeah, there is no concept of sin, or if the word is used, it's redefined. Mm-hmm. I used to hear sometimes that sin is really not being true to your real self. So if you're not being true to your real self, to who you are and are meant to be, then that's sort of a sin. But it doesn't really have a moral, doesn't carry a moral component to it. And so there really is, since there is no real concept of sin, there's no concept of salvation. Mm. You know, it's more, instead of those two concepts, the concepts are more being spiritually unawakened and needing to be spiritually awakened. Yeah. So it's non-awakening versus awakening or liberation. And this is also, you see in the Eastern views where you have to become aware of this inner nature that's divine, or in Buddhism, you become aware that there is no self. There is only formlessness, which is sometimes called Buddha nature. Mm-hmm. So there's form and formlessness, and everything is true is actually formlessness. And form is really just a temporary convention that we see and manifest in this life because we're attached to it. Mm. So that view is transferred to the New Age, as well as in the New Thought movement. They teach that Jesus came to tell us that we need to change our perception of reality. Mm. And so everything in the New Age is about a change in consciousness and a change in perception. So if you are perceiving things wrongly, and you are perceiving a reality that is false, and that is why you are not progressing, and that is why you aren't achieving, and that is why you aren't successful. And you can see this even in the extreme self-help and motivational groups, like run by people like Tony Robbins, mm-hmm. where they say you need to awaken this. He has a book called The Giant Within, I think, or Awaken the Giant Within or something mm-hmm. like that. You have to awaken this other view, this other self that's sleeping. You need to completely change your worldview. Werner Erhard, who started the EST seminars in the 70s, mm-hmm. this was his approach too, is that you have to change, you have to forget everything you learned, and you have to have a whole new, different perception of reality. Mm. So whenever you hear that kind of thinking, you're entering into this New Age territory.
Yeah.
That's a big red flag.
Yeah. Well, that is good stuff. And if anyone's listening and they want to learn more, pick up Marcia's book called Spellbound, The Paranormal Seduction of Today's Kids, which I've read, and it's fantastic. It gives you a lot of really practical examples as well of things to be looking for. And her website is ChristianAnswersForTheNewAge.org. Her ministry is, do you just call it Cana? C-A-N-A?
Yeah, I just call it Cana, or Christian Answers for the New Age. Cana is kind of the acronym.
Yeah. So check her out. Find her on Facebook. She posts a lot and is very interactive. So if you have questions, she loves to interact. Marcia, thank you so much for taking the time to do this series with me. I think that it has been incredibly, if I may use a buzzword, enlightening. I've learned a lot, and I know our listeners have as well. So thank you.
Well, thank you for having me on. I enjoyed every minute of it, and the time went by very, very quickly for me.
Yes, it did. If you enjoyed listening to this podcast, you can sign up to receive my posts by email by going to alisachilders.com and clicking the subscribe button, or simply subscribe to the Alisa Childers podcast on iTunes.